Coronet, an imprint of Hodder & Stoughton Limited, presents The Scent of Flowers at Night by Leïla Slimani. Translated by Sam Taylor. Read by Sarah Slimani. If solitude exists, and I don't know if it does, one should certainly have the right to dream of it occasionally as a paradise. Albert Camus. Where there is art and genius, there can never be such things as old age or loneliness or sickness, and death itself is half. Anton Chekhov. To Jean-Marie La Clavotine, who helped me become a writer. To my friend Salman Rushdie. Paris, December 2018. The first rule when you are trying to write a novel is to say no. No, I won't meet up for a drink. No, I can't look after my sick nephew. No, I'm not free for lunch, for an interview. No, I can't go for a walk or see a film. You have to say no so often that the offers become rarer, the telephone stops ringing, and you start to regret the fact that all your emails are adverts. You have to say no so often that people think you're an arrogant misanthrope, a pathological loner. You have to build a fortress of refusal around yourself so that all those requests and invitations will smash against its walls. This is what my editor told me when I began writing novels. It's what I read in all the essays on writing by Roth, by Stevenson, and by Hemingway, who boiled the advice down into a simple dictum. The telephone and visitors are the work destroyers. He added that once the writer has acquired the necessary discipline, once literature has become the centre, the sole horizon of their life, solitude becomes easy. The further you go in writing, the more alone you are. Most of your best and oldest friends die. Others move away. You are more alone because that is how you must work, and the time to work is shorter all the time. And if you waste it, you feel you have committed a sin for which there is no forgiveness. For the last few months, I have forced myself to follow this advice, to put in place the conditions of my isolation. In the morning, as soon as my children are at school, I go up to my office and I don't come out again until evening. I turn off my phone, I sit at my desk or I lie on the sofa. I always end up feeling cold. And as the hours pass, I put on a sweater, then another one, before finally wrapping myself in a blanket. My office measures 10 by 12 feet. A window on the right-hand wall overlooks a courtyard. The air there is filled with restaurant smells, detergent and lentils with bacon. In front of me, a long wooden plank serves as my desk. The shelves are cluttered with history books and newspaper cuttings. On the left-hand wall are post-it notes in various colours. Each colour corresponds to a particular year. Pink for 1953, yellow for 1954, green for 1955. On these squares of paper, I have written names of characters, ideas for scenes. Mathilde at the cinema, Aisha in the quince orchard. One day, when I was feeling inspired, I set down the chronology for this novel on which I am working, and which does not yet have a title. It tells the story of a family in the small town of McNairs between the end of the Second World War and the beginning of Moroccan independence. A map of the town, printed in 1952, is spread out on the floor. You can clearly see the borders between the Arab quarters, the Jewish mellah, and the European district. Today is not a good day. I've been sitting on this chair for hours, and my characters aren't speaking to me. Nothing comes. Not a word, not an image, not the hint of a musical phrase that might lead me to put a few sentences down on the page. All day long, I've smoked too much, I've wasted my time in rabbit holes online, I've taken a nap. Still, nothing has come. I wrote a chapter, which I then deleted. Now I think about a story a friend told me, I don't know if it's true, but I liked it a lot. While he was working on Anna Karenina, Tolstoy suffered a severe case of writer's block. For weeks, he didn't write a single line. His editor, who had paid him a considerable advance for the book, was alarmed by the delay in receiving the manuscript and, after writing several letters and getting no response, decided to take the train to Tolstoy's house to question him. When he arrived at Yasnaya Polyana, the novelist welcomed him into his home. The editor asked what was happening with the novel, and Tolstoy replied, "Anna Karenina has left. I am waiting for her to return." Of course, I cannot compare myself to that Russian genius or any of my novels to his masterpieces, but I am obsessed by that phrase, "Anna Karenina has left." I too sometimes feel as if my characters have escaped me, that they have gone away to lead another life and will return only when they are ready. They are utterly indifferent to my distress, my prayers, indifferent even to the love that I feel for them. They have left, and I must wait for them to return. When they are here, the days fly by. I mutter to myself. I write as fast as I can, always afraid that my hands will not be able to keep up with the speed of my thoughts. In such moments, I am terrified by the idea that something might break my concentration, like a tightrope walker who makes the momentary mistake of looking down. When my characters are here, my whole life revolves around that obsession, and the outside world ceases to exist. It becomes nothing more than a film set through which I walk, my mind lit up at the end of a long, sweet day of work. I live apart from others. This seclusion seems to me the one condition necessary for life to happen. As if, by separating myself from the noise of the world, by protecting myself, another world might emerge from within me. A once upon a time. I slip into this small, silent space, far from the madding crowd, and sink beneath the thick foam of things. I do not close myself to the world. On the contrary, I experience it more strongly than ever. Writing is discipline. It is giving up on happiness, on the little joys of everyday life. You can't try to cure or console yourself. In fact, you must cultivate your sorrows, the way lab techs cultivate bacteria in glass jars. You must reopen old wounds, stir up old memories, relive old shames, retaste old tears. To write, you must refuse yourself to others, refuse them your presence, your love. You must disappoint your friends and your children. For me, this discipline is a source of satisfaction, even happiness, and at the same time, the cause of my melancholy. My whole life is dictated by these imperatives. I must be silent. I must concentrate. I must stay seated. I must resist my desires. Writing is a sort of imprisonment, but its very shackles contain within them the possibility of an immense, dizzying freedom. I remember the moment when I first became aware of this. It was in December 2013, and I was writing my first novel, Adèle. At the time, I was living in an apartment on Boulevard Rochouart. I had a little boy, and I could only write when he was at nursery. I was sitting at the dining room table, and I thought, right now, you could say absolutely anything you want. You, the polite child who was taught always to behave, to rein yourself in. You can tell the truth. You don't have to consider anyone else's feelings. You have nothing to fear. Write whatever you want. In that vast place of freedom, the social mask falls from your face. You can be someone else. You are no longer defined by your gender, your social class, your religion, or your nationality. Writing is discovering the freedom to invent yourself and the world. Of course, there are many hard days like this one, and sometimes they pile up one after another. It can be deeply discouraging. But writing is as addictive as opium. And the writer, like all addicts, forgets the sickening side effects, the withdrawal symptoms, the loneliness, and remembers only the ecstasy. The writer will do anything to feel that high again, that sublime moment when their character starts speaking through them, when life pulsates with possibility. It's 5 o'clock. Outside, night has fallen. I haven't turned on the desk lamp, so my office is in darkness too. I start to believe that in this darkness, something might happen. A last-minute flash of inspiration. Sometimes, in the absence of light, dreams and hallucinations grow wild, like vines. I open my laptop and reread a scene I wrote yesterday. It's about an afternoon that my character spends at the cinema. What films were they showing at the Empire Cinema in McNess in 1953? I do some research. I find some very moving old photographs online and quickly send them to my mother. I start to write. I remember what my grandmother told me once about the big, heavy-handed Moroccan usherette who used to grab cigarettes out of people's mouths if they smoked during the film. I am getting ready to begin a new chapter when an alarm buzzes on my phone. I have a meeting in half an hour. A meeting I didn't manage to say no to. Alina, the editor I'm about to meet, is a persuasive woman. A passionate woman who has a proposal for me. I think about sending her a message, some simple lie to get me out of this meeting. I could make up an excuse involving my children. Tell her that I'm ill, that I missed my train, that my mother needs me. But I don't do any of these things. Instead, I put on my coat, slip the laptop into my bag, leave my lair, and venture out into the world. In the metro, on the way to the meeting, I curse myself. You'll never get anywhere if you can't focus fully on your work. Outside the cafe, where I smoke a cigarette as I wait for Alina, I swear to myself that I will say no. Say no to anything she suggests, no matter how interesting it might sound. Say, I'm writing a novel and I don't want to do anything else. Maybe later, but not now. I have to project an aura of inflexibility, an unbreakable determination. We sit on the terrace despite the December cold. In Paris, nobody seems to find it odd when people sit outside for a drink in the middle of winter, holding a cigarette between their frozen fingers. I order a glass of wine, thinking it might dissolve my melancholy. My ridiculous melancholy. How can anyone be sad just because they haven't managed to write? Alina talks to me about her project, a new series of books entitled My Night at the Museum. But I am so riddled with doubt and guilt that I hardly hear a word she says. By the time my glass is empty, I am starting to think that I may never be able to write again, that I will never finish another novel. I am so anguished that it hurts to swallow. So, what do you think? Alina asks me, about the idea of being locked up for a night in a museum. It wasn't the museum that convinced me. Alina's proposal was tempting, of course. Sleeping in the Punta della Dogana, the legendary Venice monument, now transformed into a museum of contemporary art. In truth, the thought of sleeping close to works of art leaves me cold. I nurture no fantasies about having those paintings and sculptures all to myself. I don't believe I will see them any better without the crowds, that I will gain a deeper understanding of their meaning because we are face to face. Not for one moment did I think I might have something significant to write about contemporary art. I don't know much about it. I'm not really interested in it. No. What I liked about Alina's proposal, what drove me to say yes, was the idea of being locked up. The idea that nobody could get hold of me, that the world would be out of reach. Being alone in a place that nobody else could enter, a place from which I couldn't escape, it's a writer's fantasy. All of us have these cloistered dreams, visions of a room of our own where we would be both prisoner and guard. I found it in all the private diaries, all the letters written by novelists, that desire for silence. That dream of an isolation where there is nothing to prevent the act of creation. The history of literature is filled with famous recluses, intensely solitary men and women. It has been built over years, from Holderlin to Emily Bronte, from Petrarch to Flaubert, from Kafka to Rilke. This myth of the writer isolated from the world, separated from the crowd, determined to devote their life to literature. A friend of mine, a very successful writer, admitted to me once that he had never been as happy as he was the day when, on the verge of exhaustion, he broke his leg. I spent a month and a half locked in my apartment, and I wrote, and nobody could say a thing, because I had the perfect excuse of being in a plaster cast from my foot to my hip. I have often thought of picking up a hammer and breaking my own tibia. Writing is a battle for immobility, for concentration. A physical combat in which you must constantly master your desire to live, your desire to be happy. I would like to withdraw from the world, to enter my novel the way a nun enters a convent, to make a vow of silence, of modesty, of total submission to my work. I would like to be devoted solely to words, to forget every aspect of ordinary life, not to have to worry about anything beyond the fates of my characters. For my previous novels, I did withdraw in that way, to a house in the countryside or a hotel in a foreign city. For 3 or 4 days, I would be locked away and I would lose all sense of time. To finish Lullaby, I went to Normandie on my own. For a whole week, I saw no one. I didn't hear the sound of my own voice. I didn't wash, didn't brush my hair. I hung around the silent house in pyjamas, eating whatever I wanted whenever I felt hungry. I didn't answer the phone, didn't open any letters or bills. I shirked all my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.